Bendigo is a city famous for its gold rush. But yesterday, it was a Western Australian who rushed into town to collect the yellow jersey.
He really has been the man of the race today, totally inspired.
With Cameron Meyer taking the stage, he's moved into the overall race lead. For stage two, they make their way from Bendigo to Nagambi. It's a flat stretch of road that's sure to suit the sprinters, but there's crosswinds that could play a part. Anything can still happen. The race is wide open.
Hello and welcome back to our coverage of the 62nd at Jayco Herald Sun Tour. We're now on day three. Yesterday we arrived in Bendigo. Today we restart from the city right here on the original velodrome, which is the home here of Scott McGrory. This was the start of your road to Sydney and that gold medal in 2000, wasn't it?
Absolutely, Phil. Did a lot of racing on this track. We have the Bendigo International Madison on this. It's coming up in March, actually. But fantastic venue, great racing. And even last night there was club racing on here and it was just packed.
Well, great memories on this track, but what memories there were yesterday when we did arrive in Bendigo, because 21 riders finished nearly half an hour ahead of the rest. So this race is now down to a battle of 21. And one in particular as well, because Cam Meyer, who won the stage, we thought he'd punctured in our coverage, but he hadn't, had he?
He hadn't. Well, it looked pretty obvious when we saw it, didn't we, that he went and changed his front wheel. That wasn't the case. He had a shallow front wheel in because they thought it was going to be crosswinds. And then he actually thought that he had such a big chance and he was so confident of winning the stage, he went back and changed for a deeper, more aerodynamic, faster front wheel. Extraordinary. I've never seen anyone do that before, but Cam came away with the victory, so it was the right move.
Huge confidence, the man who once won national championships on this very track as well. Well, before we go to the action, let's hear from Cam Meyer himself.
We had quite a few hills at the start with Mount Macedon, Mount Alexander, and when I reconned this course a few days ago, it was really windy, so I went with a shallower wheel for the start. And then when we read the situation that it was going to be a 20-man attacking flat style finish with not much wind, I went, righto, let's put the bigger wheels in and let's look for the stage win.
Was that a risk?
Not really. We were rolling along pretty slow. Everyone was trying to analyse the situation. It was too far out for guys to attack. So I had a moment there where it just slowed up enough for me to stop, pull over, change the wheel, just relax and get the real wheels in and get ready for a last 20k smackdown, I guess.
Well, Cam Meyer in the yellow jersey now. It should be a quieter day for him. It's one for the sprinters, isn't it?
You would think so, and I think that yellow jersey should be secure on the shoulders of Cameron Meyer. Caleb Ewan, his teammate, would be probably the favourite for the stage if it comes down to a bunch sprint, but there are so many teams that want to go up the road and get on the attack, and there were five teams that missed that move yesterday, so they really are looking for redemption. So there'll be a lot of action and a short stage as well. There's always really a lot of fireworks in these short stages. There'll be a lot to do today.
We're heading down to Nagambi. Let's talk tactics.
Rightio, well, the tactics for today's stage here in the Herald Sun Tour are, it could be a bit of a crazy one. I mean, yesterday we had obviously 21 riders sneak up the road and take a huge amount of time, so that settled the GC battle. So obviously you'll have all those guys marking each other. But the good thing is with all those bigger teams, they've all got some very good sprinters in them. So there's a good chance that it'll suit all of them to bring it back for a bunch sprint. Now our team, the Quartermantha Australian national team, is Steele Van Hoff, so that'll suit us just fine. We've got a couple of guys in Lockie Morton and Chris Hamilton that were in the break yesterday, so it'll suit us for them to have as an easier day as possible and not lose time. And personally, I'm pretty excited as we come along the road beside Lake Nagambi, and I think I've driven up and down that road many more times than anyone else in my days at rowing. I know exactly which way the wind blows, so hopefully we'll have a little bit of an upper hand if it does come into that much-anticipated bunch sprint.
Cam Worth, rowing and sprinting, he knows Nagambi very well indeed. Well, this is the Chinese Dragon Dance, and of course the Chinese New Year is literally just around the corner. Our thanks to the Victorian police keeping the race on the straight and narrow as the sprinters start to sign in here, thinking of a big fast finish in Nagambi. Well, let's find out as we go to Matthew Keenan as to what the riders are thinking of the day.
Intriguing day yesterday, but you guys were so well represented. What happens from here?
Yeah, well, look, we put ourselves in the box seat, really. Orica are the best team here, and we're lined up behind them. So we're from here. We've got to keep our attention on them and look for when their next split's going to happen. They're not taking 21 guys on GC to Sunday, so we've got to be ready for that.
What's it feel like to wake up with yellow?
Yeah, it feels good. Any time you're in a yellow jersey means you've ridden a good race and you're in a good position. So I've been in that at the Tour Down Under, and the same thing, it was really close on seconds. So I know what it's like to be only leading by a small margin. So we've got our work cut out for us for the team, but I think we're up to the challenge.
Let's have a look at the course for stage two of the Jayco Herald Sun Tour. Bendigo to Ngambia over 118 kilometres. Starting at the Velodrome in Bendigo, they head out to Strathfield Say at the first intermediate sprint there, around Lake Eppalock, and then a tricky descent and climb out of Reedsdale for the first and only King of the Mountain sprint of the day, through Heathcote for the second and final intermediate sprint, and then a fairly straight shot right through to Ngambia, but they'll actually meet a 180-degree turn 400 metres from the finish line. That's going to be very tricky for the sprinters. Not so difficult regardless of what the profile looks. Looks like the side of a saw blade, Phil, but it's not too hard out on course at all.
And resplendent in the lead is a yellow jersey, Cameron Meyer, who comes from Perth, by the way, as they roll away. Now, this is a novel start, Scott, going around the velodrome here before we go out on the course.
Well, I like it, Phil. I've ridden on this track so many times. Bendigo International Madison, a feature on this velodrome every March. For the first three laps around here, it's only neutralised. Some great shots as they go past the Frank McCaig Memorial Stand. We had the Frank McCaig Memorial Sprint as they came into Bendigo yesterday. A little bit of leisurely time for the riders, not under pressure. The actual race official kilometre zero is not until they get further out of town.
Time for the riders to reflect on where you'll be along the road today, because the temperature's rising all of the time today, a high expected of 33. For some of the Europeans, it might be a shock as they now leave the track here, led out by Caleb Ewan, the likely winner today. He's a big sprinter. He was rested during the Santos Tour Down Under for this race. There he is in the dead centre. All nice and relaxed as they move out onto the course. Now, the first sprint of the day comes at Strathfield Say, and that's only 6 kilometres down the road, so we can expect a very fast start once that flag comes in.
There's Michael Hepburn there from Orica Green Edge, just controlling the front of the pace, the front of the peloton here. There's the yellow jersey of Cameron Meyer, his teammate. So you'd expect to see a lot of Orica Green Edge at the start of the race here, Phil, just keeping an eye on any of those early attacks that no doubt will come very quickly.
Well, this could be a feature along the route. We pass through the towns along the way. All the school kids are back at school and out on a few moments off to watch the race go by. And this is the first big attack of the day.
And it is Craig Evers just going at the right time, because they're coming into Strathfield Say now, and the first intermediate sprint is just there in front of them. He timed that perfectly.
He did. He's only 24 years of age, and the day two, three youngster gets across the line. He gets the points in the chain reaction sprint there. There isn't one now for quite some way. The next one will be a Heathcote. And there's the full result. 6 points in there. And Joel Strachan and Joshua Evanson, the British rider, gets 2 points. Now, the pressure has stayed on here. And the way these riders are going, I would think there's quite a big element in this peloton trying to make amends for yesterday, because after they lost 25 minutes yesterday, a lot of the team managers really tore into the riders last night.
Well, there were five teams that missed the breakaway group in stage one, and you'd expect absolutely that those teams would be very animated. Now, United Health were in the breakaway group. They were well represented as well, and they have a fast sprinter for today's stage in John Murphy. But the black colours that just went off to the right of screen there, that's the British team JLT Condor. They were one of the teams that were heavily criticised by their team manager, John Herity, for missing yesterday's move. So expect to see them on the attack.
Lots of movement here. We've gone from the left to the right. Now it's the youngsters on the Great Britain under 23 squad who are starting to pile on the pressure. They're the next ones to have a go. Interesting tactics, these. They're trying to get a group going, but you know, they're so tenacious today and they're chasing everything down. Here we go again now.
Paul van der Ploeg from Charter Mason, another one of the teams that missed the move yesterday. So Paul trying to get something to stick, and it's his brother Neil. So the two van der Ploegs trying to work together off the front. Now, Avanti Racing did have four riders in that group yesterday. They had a fantastic stage one, but it wasn't Neil that made that group. So the two van der Ploegs, former mountain bikers, now joining forces out in front.
And they've got good form, both of them, but Neil in the front at the moment. He's the rider who got the bronze medal in the National Road Race Championships this year in Ballarat and Buninyong. Little flick of the elbow saying, OK, you've caught us, now come and help us. Pressure has been really on here. We are averaging at the moment just under 50 kilometres an hour since the start.
The red colours of Will Clark now coming to the front. Trafac professional cycling team, the first yellow jersey wearer of this year's race after winning the prologue time trial in Melbourne. And now such a strong rider as well. This is the sort of stage that can suit a rider like Will Clark. He's such a strong rider. They call him the horse because he's so powerful.
Well, Clark willing to get something going. He's one of the riders who lost big time yesterday when he was wearing the leader's yellow jersey. Now he's going to have to try and make amends. There's no chance he can regain the yellow jersey, but he could, of course, win the stage. And that really will be his next target now. This is Alex Clements here, one of the youngsters on the Jayco AIS squad, willing to work with Clark.
Well, two strong riders here. Now it's really just up to what happens back in the main field. There's so many riders that did miss that move yesterday. They don't want to see another group go away without any representation. So we're not sure if this one's going to stick just yet. We'll have to look back to the main field and see who is trying to make the move to come across.
The roads are gently rolling for the next few kilometres before we get down to Redsdale. Then we start to plunge down into the valleys across a very narrow bridge, and then we start the climb out. And that would be, I would expect, someone to make a move that might stick. At the moment, all of these attacks are something of weakness for the peloton, which has been under pressure ever since the off.
The Charter Mason rider there trying to go over the top was Edwards. Now it's been replaced by Ben Hill now from Charter Mason. So very animated is the red, white and blue colours of Charter Mason. Also the African Wildlife Safari team, they missed yesterday's move. There's the black colours of JLT, the British team. So these are all the teams that we've been talking about, Phil. Meanwhile, Orica Green Edge, who it's their obligation to look after the race, don't have to do too much at all.
And today, the survivors of the Jayco Herald Sun Tour are bound for Nagambi. This is a beautiful sun-drenched town with a mild climate and is famous for its local produce. It's also the place to relax and enjoy life in itself.
Hello and welcome to stage two of the Jayco Herald Sun Tour. Just a quick recap on yesterday. The Avanti Racing team, we had four riders up the road, and Patrick Bevan and Joe Cooper were third and second. So they say cycling's a team sport, but it's not. It really isn't. Like, in fact, it's a pretty devastating result yesterday. Mitch Lovelock Fay and myself lost 25 minutes. So, you know, in comparison to the other guys, it makes us look bad, really bad. Like, we look shocking. So today, it's about getting up the road, Mitch and myself, and sending a statement to Andrew Christie Johnson and the management at Avanti that we're down, but we're not out. We're in this.
Well, Neil, we all believe you. We've already seen you out on the attack with your brother, but right now we're all back together again. MTN Quebec are making a move.
Well, that's Matthew Goss himself, the sprinter from the team, formerly from Orica Green Edge. He had 3 years with that team and now across to MTN Quebec, trying to do something and salvage something out of this race for himself. Going pretty fast as well, opening up a gap there. Neil Vanderpoel is such a joker, isn't he? It'd be quite refreshing to have a rider like him in the racing. Having to touch the brakes there, he was coming so fast up onto the motorcycle there, Matt Goss. Good to see him motivated at the start of the year, Phil.
Well, he's looking to get away off the front, and that's a good sign. He's searching for a breakaway here because the pace is still very much on. As we're heading up to an hour on the road now, almost 50 kilometres covered in the hour. That is a very, very quick start indeed, and they're still looking for a split that might go places. Everybody is chasing everybody just now.
One of those riders doing a lot of the chasing I saw there was Stiel van Hoff, Phil. He's one of the favourites to take out the stage finish in a sprint, yet he's also getting himself in the mix, trying to go in some of these moves. This looks like the Jayco AIS under 23 rider, Jack Beckinsale, perhaps, trying to get off the front as well.
We'll always reckon that they will be on the attack together. There's three riders coming up here. Now, United Healthcare in the blue and white, being shadowed a lot by Drapac today. They're coming up to form a little group at the front here. Now that is Ryan Kavanagh up there now in the under 23 colours of Australia. That's put four riders up in the front. Avanti coming across, and there's again a reaction from the field. This is keeping a very, very quick schedule today. They're going to hit Ngambi about 10 or 15 minutes before expected time if they keep this pressure on.
Well, it's as if all of the riders that missed the move yesterday are desperate to get into the winning one today. And now some sort of control over the peloton. Michael Hepburn coming up here, the former world champion in the individual and team pursuit on the track. Patrick Bevan just on the left there in the blue and orange colours as well. So all the contenders now coming towards the front.
I think that's the tactic now, because there's no real interest in pushing this pace as high as this. Oh, there's a problem there for Chris Hamilton. I can hear from race radio, in fact, he's grabbed a wheel and they're getting him back on the road. But it's going to be a tough chase back, because these boys are attacking and counter-attacking. There's a move on the right there by Tyler Farrar, but I think I saw one of the English riders sort of move out of the way. Let's have a look at that again in the centre of our picture. There's the hand up from the British rider. And it was as if Tyler Farrar said, move out, I want a counter. And he's coming up on the outside of the road. Let's get back to the action, because he's joined the three leaders. And now we have Michael Cumming of the JLT squad. Tyler Farrar, who's won stages in all of the Grand Tours, France, Italy and Spain. Good to see him on the attack, actually, for a sprinter. And Will Clark.
Strong little move, and I agree with you. Looking back at that replay, it did look as if maybe Tyler Farrar had said something quite aggressively, perhaps, and the GB rider moved out of his way quite happily. Now coming into Reedsdale here, and this is where they start this descent down toward the very tricky bridge. It splits into two, and it's an old-fashioned wooden bridge, the old pick-a-plank type of bridge. They can be quite dangerous, and then there is a hill straight up from the other side. 10% gradient as they come down towards it, so very fast as well. Hopefully all the riders will get across this bridge safely.
Beautiful scenery, I have to say. These boys have just made the move, and now they're going to try and consolidate, because once over this bridge, which is literally around the corner, they climb steeply away on the only noted climb of the day. We're running through 44 kilometres here. Red lights, but don't worry about that. Victoria, please have this bridge closed for the direction of the race here. All breathe in, and it's Will Clark who gets on. This is a really dicey section.
Well, Mike Cumming, I know, has been out here and looked at this course. The team's been staying in Bendigo, just down the road, so they've come out and done the recce on it. You can see the peloton now much more hesitant as they come across. But so far, everybody's made it across safely. The yellow jersey of Cameron Meyer gets across unscathed, and now they've slowed right down to go across that bridge and then directly up into the King of the Mountains.
Well, everybody's safely over. This is Simon Clark, last year's winner here, chatting with Matt Wilson, the team director for Orica GreenEdge. Unusual to see the defending champion becoming the water carrier, but he wants to know details of the breakaway, and quite clearly now defending the lead of his teammate Cam Meyer.
Well, the three riders out in front, they're not dangerous to the overall lead of Cameron Meyer. They're so far behind in the overall classification. So for Orica GreenEdge, they don't have to ride a fast tempo now. Sure, they will go to the front because it's their obligation with the race leader to do some sort of tempo setting, but it doesn't have to try and be to bring that group back into the fold. That'll be left to the other teams that are really focusing on that sprint towards the end.
Well, that was the order over the top of the budget forklifts. King of the Mountains, Tyler Farrar. He's not the best climber in the world, and he'd probably be the first to tell you that, has gone over the top ahead of Will Clark and Michael Cumming. The gap timed here at 1:19 as the rest of the peloton comes up, and they're just safely over that picker plank bridge and reorganising themselves. More preoccupied right now with requests for water, because it's getting pretty hot out here.
Still a little bit of a move off the front of the peloton. You see those three riders that went away. Once everybody realised that Orica GreenEdge were not so committed to try to bring them back, then it was an opportunity for other riders perhaps to go on the move.
And just close to the finishing line today in Ngambi is this beautiful bronze statue of Black Caviar, one of the town's most famous inhabitants. And born here in 2006, she was never beaten in 25 starts. And now she continues as a champion, producing winners of the future away from the turf. Back with the action now. These three are making good, steady progress. They've got clear. They're building time. They're leaving themselves an awful long way to stay away. But on their side, Scott, is they were in that 25-minute group yesterday, so they've lost a lot of time.
Well, the gap now 1:45, but it did take almost 40 kilometres for this group to actually get established off the front. It was so fast early on, it was quite a while to get this particular type configuration. Will Clark is a specialist at this type of attack as well. He's such a strong rider.
Well, we've seen how good he is at Prologue time trialing. He won on day one of this event in the evening in the CBD district of Melbourne in the Cordamentha Prologue, but now he's having to attack and try and fly the Drapac colours again up front. They lost their grip on the overall classification yesterday. Tyler Farrett, it's his first year with this African MTN Quebecer team, and he would like a good season, and he's showing us now by attacking early on today he's not going to rely on his sprint. He wants some good training miles down under.
Well, it's a roll of the dice, isn't it, from Tyler? Just hoping that Orica Green Edge don't worry too much about this group out in front. Well, the kids are certainly worrying about them. They're loving it, seeing the riders coming through. But if Orica Green Edge do allow them 3 to 3.5 minutes, Phil, there is a real chance that they can take it all the way to the line, because the pressure will then go onto the other teams that weren't in the mix yesterday, because they'll need to try and get something out of this stage. 100 metres now to the second intermediate sprint. This one is in Heathcote, but you can see they're not going for this. Tyler Farrar going over to pick up the points in front of Mike Cumming. And then it was Will Clark, but they've mutual agreement amongst the three, Phil. They've decided to not go for these sprints and just try and work as hard as they can to stay away from the peloton.
Well, there's the face of Will Clark. Yes, they're thinking long term here as they race directly towards Melbourne right now. That will all change in a couple of kilometres as we'll turn left, bound for Nagambi. The last 55 kilometres of the day through beautiful wooded territory. Good roads to race on, because we're always twisting and turning, but there has been a reaction from that field. And wisely here, Tyler Farrar comes from the colder climes of the USA right now, is packing in those water bottles.
Picked up those points there as they came through town just before the feed, but you can see it's United Healthcare on the front. Their man John Murphy is one of the favourites to take out the sprint, so they've decided to get up here and make sure the gap doesn't get too big. Just getting close to 2 minutes as they came through.
Yes, inside 2 minutes now, and they were at one stage approaching 3 minutes. So there is a reaction from the field. Mike Cumming here, he's been over here living in Bendigo and riding pretty well, training. Now he's getting his rewards for the hard work and the lonely hours put in. Boy, old Tyler Farrar here is ramming down the food. He's really thinking, if it came to the finish, of course, I don't think anybody would match Tyler in the sprint. There we are, the left-hand turn, just under the 50-kilometre marker to go.
Just looking at United Healthcare on the front of the main field, with these three riders now, I guess, on the string of the peloton. They've been contained. The gap has now started to come down. What I'm noticing, though, is no Orica Green Edge riders having to do any of the work. So this really does set the stage for Caleb Bewin to try and go for a sprint victory at the end. They can save all of their energy there. So the work that they would normally be required to do is being done by other teams. So this is a really positive thing for Orica Green Edge.
I'll look back with the peloton now. They're about to make their left-hand turn here. Well, they've gained since they came through that sprint. The pressure has gone off in the peloton. It's gone up again, and it's up to 2.5 minutes. So they picked up 40 seconds down the highway. I don't think any of this is of the concern of the maillot jaune, the yellow jersey of Cam Meyer, surrounded by his teammates. This is turning out to be a perfect day for them. They'd love to catch the breakaway and perhaps give their sprinter a chance of winning, Caleb Bewin, but they're not too concerned whether they catch him or not.
I think they'll just worry about that. If the other teams do want to close the gap down, then certainly they'll line it up for the sprint for Caleb Bewin. And there's Joe Cooper in the Chain Reaction Cycles green points leader's jersey. It's actually Cameron Meyer that's in the lead of that competition, but he has the yellow. He can't wear two jerseys. So second place in that competition is to Joe Cooper. Michael Cumming now on the front of the group for the JLT Condor team. We've been talking about them. They were desperate to get up the road yesterday. It didn't work out for them, but they've made it into the split with Mike Cumming.
Tyler Farrar still working very hard. These boys, I'm sensing from their body language, are thinking they might just hold this peloton off today. And maybe that's why we've got one team now riding at the front, and Charter Mason have called up the men. It's not over yet. And as the riders in the Jayco Herald Sun Tour race into the last 40 kilometres of the day, meanwhile in the Gambia, they're having a wonderful time. It's market day and everybody is up for the arrival of the big race. And down the road now at the 40 kilometre point as we race through the gum trees. These three riders are still living in hope and they still have a chance. Will Clark, Tyler Farrow, Michael Cumming, three countries, three different nationalities.
We can see several different teams coming to the front of the peloton as well now, just trying to control the pace and make sure that group doesn't line up too much. And here's the under 23 national team all together. Now their best man is Robert Power, and Matt Keenan caught up with him.
The rider who's been labelled as the rising star of Australian cycling hails from Western Australia. He rides with the Australian under 23 team, and appropriately, his name is Robert Power, and he's got plenty of it. Next year, he'll be with Orica Green Edge, but first, he wants to beat them. Let's meet him. How'd you get into cycling? Was it part of the family, or you discovered it elsewhere?
I got into it from a knee injury, actually, and just got on the velodrome and started riding, try and get a bit of rehab, start playing rugby again, and kind of stayed on the track and moved over to the road.
There's a few unique qualities that I've never seen before. I mean, there's a pain threshold there that when he goes uphill, he just finds something more every time, particularly the big mountains that we've seen in Europe so far.
I mean, I've got a lot of work to do, I think, to be around the mark in the mountains, and at Tour Down Under, I realised I've still got a lot of work to do, and this year I think it's going to be a big learning curve, and got to really work hard over the European season this year, I think.
We've never had a really pure climber that I've been able to work with, and now that I've had that opportunity, and I'd put Jack Haig in the same sort of class as far as their abilities and what they're potentially going to bring to Green Edge in the next few years.
What about the amount of media attention that you've had, though? Have you found that?
Yeah, it's been a bit of a shock at first, but I mean, it's all just, I think, just getting used to it, and I think it's all part of cycling. And it's obviously after stages when you've got to do interviews and it slows down your recovery, but I think that's all part of it, and it's been a good learning experience.
And next season, Orica Green Edge?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be a massive step up, but I'm really looking forward to it. They're a great team, and already going on the camp with them, I really enjoyed it, so I think it's going to be a really good fit, me being in that team, and I'm really looking forward to it.
And then just over the next couple of days, you can beat them.
Yeah, hopefully.
Australia, big hope for the future there. Well, the only climb of the day has gone by. It hasn't affected his overall lead in the budget forklifts King of the Mountains. He'll wear that jersey again tomorrow, and the push is on with 26 kilometres to go.
Cameron Meyer in the yellow jersey looking fairly relaxed. His team doesn't have to do any of the work at the moment, so they'd be quite happy about that. To the gap at 1 minute and 30 seconds. That is quite controllable, and you'd expect those three riders out in front now. Will Clark and also Tyler Ferrara. Mike Cumming just in the background, starting to really struggle towards the back. You can just see the face of Mike Cumming. It does appear that the peloton seems to have them within their grips.
I thought there that Mike Cumming was beginning to look as though he was going to shake his head. He's dropped off the back. He's had enough. Well, I think he may be saving a little bit of energy, so he comes in with the main field, if he can, into Ngambi, because the field is closing in. 25 kilometres to go. We've only got two left, and the gap now is closing very rapidly.
United Healthcare on the front of the peloton once again, doing their job for John Murphy. So they'll be really trying to, actually they'll be bolstered by the fact that they know that it's down to two riders. The information would have come back to the teams as well that Mike Cumming has been dropped. Cameron Worth from the Quarter Mentha national team up here. So he's doing the job for his teammate Steele Von Hoff, a very fast sprinter, the Australian Criterium champion. So now several more teams coming towards the front to close the gap down.
Yes, there's a lot of riders here who've got sprinters they feel will have a chance of winning this race if they can get it together. There we are. The break is now only two, it says, and 1 minute, 23 seconds. That's the biggest termite hill I've ever seen. Except it's not a termite hill, of course.
Could have been a bit of old gold mining diggings, perhaps. But Tyler Farrar, he wasn't having a look at it, focusing on either his pedalling or up the road where he's going. Will Clark directly over the top. It's a good combination. They've been very strong together, these two. Not sure if they're going to be strong enough. The gap is coming down, and so many new, fresh faces on the front of the peloton contributing to the chase.
I think they made a good chance at this because it was a very difficult stage to break away, with speeds averaging 50 kilometres an hour over that first hour and a bit of racing. They got clear, And for a while, I really thought they were going to make it, but I don't think they possibly can now. They're clearly both suffering. The gap is at 46 seconds. United Healthcare on the blue and the white colours there are really determined. They're riding a very good race for a team that's come out of cold weather to Australia.
Also, more riders now from the Quartamenta real estate team. You can see the orange colours on the bike and the orange shoes there as well. That is Steele Von Hoff. That's the rider that they're working for. They did have Chris Hamilton up in the breakaway group and Lockie Morton yesterday. So two riders in the overall classification, Phil. But today is all about that bunch sprint. And Steele Von Hoff is the only man from Quartamenta real estate that has a chance.
15 kilometres to go. I think it's around about a minute at the moment. It's yo-yoing all of the time here. If we stay within the shadow of the gum trees, that will help the riders because they're out of sight, but no longer are they out of mind now. There is Steele Von Hoff on the Quartamenta real estate team. He is the sprinter on the squad, and he's waiting now to see those two guys come into the gun sights of the peloton.
The rider just behind Steele there is Lockie Morton. So he's the climber waiting for the Arthur's Seat final stage ascent on Sunday. Will Clark, he's not worried about that. He's just trying to get the best out of this one. On the prologue, started well, showed how good his form is. And Tyler Farrar always has that grimace on his face, but obviously very, very strong. These two guys, they see the board now. They know that perhaps the end is coming very soon. 46 seconds is only the gap. They didn't get to that three-minute mark. Really wanted to see them get over 3 minutes to give them a real chance of going all the way to the finish.
Well, 46 seconds equates to about 650 metres ahead of the peloton right now. A team car is up alongside Will Clark, who is clearly suffering. So too is the MTN Quebeca rider from the USA here, Tyler Farrar. I'm trying to think when I last saw Tyler Farrar in a breakaway, because the boy is a sprinter and clearly he wanted some hot training miles. 35 seconds, show it to us, show it to the peloton, and now go and show it to the two leaders. It's not a message they want to see. Now here's the view from a Shimano camera fitted to the front of the bike of Caleb Ewan. It's a bit busy, the traffic in front, and at the other end we can see the catch is virtually together now.
I can't wait to see the vision from that camera when we get down to the end. He is the man they're working for, Orica GreenEdge. United Healthcare, they're doing it for John Murthy. Quartamenta Real Estate, that's for Steele Von Hoff. These are big names in the world of sprinting. And it looks as if it's all said and done for the last two riders remaining. 7 kilometres to go, and Will Clark and Tyler Farrar are going to be reeled back in after 65 kilometres out in front. Now, remember, 400 metres from the finish line is a 180-degree turn. The riders have to get around that. That's going to be quite tricky. It's a straight shot to the line, but that run-in is going to be very nasty.
There's the catch. Will Clark having a chat there with Tyler Farrar, saying, well, we gave it our best shot now. They've got to hang on to a peloton, which is going to continue at high speed. Here's the look through the camera again, and Caleb Ewan trying to get through on the inside. Maybe that'll be the case at the finish as well. In the last 5 kilometres of today's stage of the Jayco Herald Sun Tour, we'll pass the Ngambi Lakes Caravan and Leisure Park and the beautiful Goulburn River, where you can water ski, fish or just swim. This is the place to be. Now, back on the bike here with Caleb Ewan as we continue towards the Leisure Park now. Not far to go, Scott.
Well, you might have just seen on the right-hand side of the shot there, Caleb Ewan actually pushed the rider out of the way. He wanted to get up onto the wheel of his teammate. You don't get to see that from these shots. It's great to get inside the peloton and just see them really pushing and shoving each other around. It's Michael Hepburn, number three. That's the wheel that he wants. That'll be the final lead-out rider for Caleb Ewan.
Right now, the lead-out rider on the front here for United Healthcare, the USA team, they've been a credit to this race. They've always had the men at the front, but they're thinking of John Murphy. If they can guide him up to the finishing line and then launch him for the line. Interesting finish it is too in the Ngambi, because we go down the back of the finish, turn a U-turn in the high road and race back up to the line. So they'll see the finish before they have to race for it.
We're just coming over the Goulburn River here now, so they're not too far until they get into Ngambi. They'll take a left-hand turn onto the main road, High Street, and then it's down to that U-turn that you just mentioned, Phil. Hepburn just struggling on the edge of the road there. There's not enough room to try and get past. Look over the shoulder, you could see Michael Hepburn looking to see where Caleb is. He doesn't want to just move up the outside. He has to make sure that Caleb is on the wheel and following him through.
And Hepburn has guided Caleb up to the back wheel out of Simon Clark, who wears number one as last year's winner. So they've got three in a line there. They've got four now from that front shot.
Well, and it's 4 kilometres left to race as well. Number 41 at the back of the group there. That's Will Clark. His job is done. The rest of the team now from Drapac Cycling will be working for Brenton Jones as we go back onto the bike with Caleb Bjorn.
Clear blue skies. It always seems to be hot in the Gambi for a big-time bicycle race coming into town as we pass the Merino sheep there. Shoulder to shoulder now. You've really got to move your sprinters to the front at this point and hold them safe. Little bit of a shoot up the outside by Michael Lovelock Faye for the Avanti squad. You can see by the speed of the race here, and you get a good idea of it off that camera. And you can see in the centre of our picture, Caleb Ewan. Well, that's the boy carrying the camera at the moment. He's just gone out of our sight now.
It's just a race between teams, isn't it, Phil, to try and do the lead out best for their riders. Pat Lane coming to the front now for African Wildlife Safaris. The Avanti Racing team around the outside as well. They've got two riders that can go for it, Patrick Bevan and also Neil van der Ploeg. Very fast sprinters indeed. And there's Christian House, the former champion, on the left-hand side in the black colours, pushing and shoving from Caleb Ewan once again. He wants to stay on the wheel of his teammate there and has to force his way through to do it.
These are nervous and very dangerous moments coming into the sprint. 2 kilometres to go. Now, if there were to be an accident in the last 3 kilometres, all of the riders would be given the same time. That's because of the nature of the route into the finish. And indeed, that's good news now for Cameron Meyer, because he can't lose his lead today in the green, in the yellow jersey competition. Here we go, just over 1¾ kilometres. We've come off the side road onto the main highway. Now that we'll go down the back of the finish eventually. And it looks to me as though at the end, Orica Greenedge have got control.
Well, Sam Bewley there just telling Damien Housen to get across to the left-hand side of the road. That means the wind's coming from the right, so they want to put everyone else in the gutter and make sure their man, Caleb Ewan, is protected. See the two black colours there? That's Felix English and Graham Briggs, the two sprinters from Great Britain. And now here come United Healthcare.
Well, they've been pushed off the front by that surge by Orica Greenedge, but they've regained control here. Now, as we race up towards the finish, the riders will bend to the right of the race as they go down the back. And now it looks to me as though United Healthcare at 1 kilometre to go. I've got John Murphy in a perfect position here. Orica Greenedge trying to intrude in those white jerseys. That Sam Bewley said, that's my turn done, and he moves away.
Well, Greenedge, Orica Greenedge were looking fantastic when they turned onto High Street, but now it's advantage to the American team, United Healthcare. They're doing it all right with about 600 metres to go. The switchback turn is about to happen.
As they race down towards the sharp turn back on themselves, this is a most crucial turn here. Remember, we're on the handlebars of Caleb Ewan here as we dodge through the inside of the riders as he fights desperately to hold onto the back wheel of his teammates. The turn is coming up.
Well, you can see how tight it is here. It's United Healthcare. First riders around the corner, 400 metres as they come out of this corner to the line. They're going to be hitting 70 kilometres per hour by the time they get to the finish.
Perfect lead out by United Healthcare for John Murphy. We're back on the saddle of Caleb Ewan, who's gone through the inside of his teammate. On the right of our picture now, Caleb Ewan is going for gold and he's going to take it on the line. 50 metres to go when this man releases himself, and down goes Brenton Jones. And I don't think he touched anybody. Well, have a look at that again. Brenton Jones has gone down. He looks a little bit stunned here, but unbelievably, nobody went down with him.
Well, very unusual for one rider to go down in a bunch sprint without seeing someone else go over the top. That was a terrible crash from Brenton Jones. 65 to 70 kilometres per hour is what he would have been doing when he hit the deck. Caleb Ewan had plenty of time to get off the handlebars, throw the two-arm salute and victory up in the air. But this is terrible to see a rider like Brenton Jones, one of the pre-race favourites, coming into this stage. Certainly out of breath. We can see it here as he's going for it on the right-hand side. That's Sam Whitmitz from the Budget Forklifts team. He's gone to go underneath, and Brenton went across to try and stop his run. It's actually Sam Whitmitz didn't do anything wrong there. There was a coming together of the two, but you could see how Brenton went across to try and shut him down, but Sam was coming through with too much speed. So it's a racing incident. But yeah, it's an unfortunate one to see Brenton go down.
Yeah, it's not good to see when you finish the race. Yeah, sprinter on the ground. So hopefully he's all right.
Well, despite the fall, Brenton Jones has crossed the line in fifth position. And now to the applause, a sympathetic applause from the crowd. It's thumbs up. He thinks he's okay. Let's hope he is. The Jayco Herald Sun Tour has reached Nagambi, but drama at the finish. Caleb Ewan, at 20 years of age, wins the stage. But as he sweats his way to the line here and gets a clear victory, watch the right of the picture. Down goes Brenton Jones of Drapac as he hits the road. Yet he slid through the photo finish and he was given fifth place. Well, he's already been taken to the ambulance, but he's given us a thumbs up on the way. And let's hope he's okay. So as he goes off to hospital, let's catch up with the man that was closest to him, and that was Sam Whitmidge talking to Matt Keenan.
Big crash on the finish line, Sam, right next to you. What happened?
Well, Matty, we don't like to see crashes, especially in sprint finishes, because, you know, the amount of damage to the bodies, you know, that's probably where it's at its highest at those high speeds. But I was coming a long way back, and, yeah, because I was coming quite a bit quicker and hard up against the fence, Brendan was slowly dying towards the line and started to move into the line, but by the time I got through, it was too late, and I think he actually clipped his handlebars on my knee as it was coming up, which flipped him. So, yeah, it's actually, it's devastating because, you know, like me and Brendan are, like, good mates, so you don't want to see anyone crash, let alone your mates. So, yeah, hopefully a really speedy recovery for him.
Felt a bit of pressure today to try to get a good result and, you know, definitely win. But, yeah, you know, it's sort of a relief coming across the line first, and, you know, a lot of pressure is lifted off your shoulders.
I really believe that the break did have a shot today because I thought Greenedge or Orca would kind of want to keep it quiet and save their legs to fight for GC, but apparently enough other teams were interested in the sprint that no luck. But it was fun. You know, it's something a little different for me. I don't ride early breaks that often, so it was an experience.
It was a little bit stressful, actually. It took 45k for the break to go. Every single team was attacking us, and we just couldn't get control of the race in that start. And I was a bit nervous there. There was breaks of like 20 to 30 guys going up the road, and it was really hard. But in the end, it did come back three guys away. Perfect sprint for Caleb, and he nailed it. So we got through the day well.
The winning move was when the team came around everyone else with about 3-4k to go and pretty much stayed in the front for the rest of the race.
Well, Caleb Ewan, who doesn't celebrate his 21st birthday until July this year, on top of the winner's podium tonight. The best young rider for Victoria State Government remains on the shoulders of Scott Davis. The most aggressive rider today for Subaru was Tyler Farrer. And in the chain reaction points competition, Cam Meyer kept his lead in that. Although the jersey will be worn tomorrow again by Joe Cooper. And still the 4-point separation there. Caleb Ewan comes up in that competition with his win into third place. In the budget forklifts King of the Mountains competition, he didn't win any points today, but he's kept his lead clearly on top. Robert Power remains there with 48 points, Brendan Canty with 20, Lachlan Norris with 16. That competition not over yet. And in the Jayco Herald Sun Tour leader's yellow jersey, well, Cameron Meyer defended it throughout the day. He's still on top. No change amongst the overall leaders because that 21 escape yesterday has kept all the riders with the same time gaps. And at the end of the day, the overall remained unchanged. I think we can say the sprinters got their own back. But poor Brenton Jones, that was a spectacular crash. First reports, though, Scott, is he'll be okay.
Off to the hospital to get some x-rays, but you know, we see this all the time in cycling. If nothing is broken, I'd expect him to be back on the bike tomorrow with a few bandages, though.
Now, what's in store tomorrow? A very hot day for starters, I think.
Today it got up over into the mid-30s. It's going to be hotter again tomorrow as they go into the Strathbogies. But starting from Mitchelton Winery, it's 146 kilometres. Two King of the Mountain climbs out on course, both Category 2. Two intermediate sprints, both of those are in Seymour. And then this exact same finish again tomorrow. Let's hope that they get across the line without any crashes.
Well, stay with us. The final weekend is on us. We have tomorrow's stage here into Nagambi again, and then the big finale on Arthur's Seat. We'll see you tomorrow. Goodbye.